distance. Blue, black, stretched to the point of no turning back. Flight of fancy on the windswept field. Standing alone, my senses reel. Fatal attraction. Irresistible grasp. Can't keep my eyes from the sunny sky. Tongue tied, twisted, just an earthbound distant eye. This edition of GATV is devoted entirely to rotorcraft. We'll look at many of the different helicopters being manufactured and even talk to some of the pilots who fly them. Then, we'll check in with our certified flight instructors for some flight training tips. Finally, we wrap things up with Master CFI Jim Alsop and his segment of Hangar Talk.
All right, you are a go. Now we see the Earth.
You've got it, buddy.
Now we see the Earth now.
You've got it, buddy.
Now we see the Earth now.
All right,
you are a go.
GATV Online's website is devoted entirely to general aviation. Not only can you watch each episode of GATV 24/7, but GATV Online can be your one stop for all of your aviation needs. Like our flight planning page, where you can check the weather, plan your flight, and even file your flight plan. And the Flying Resources page gives you quick access to many other aviation websites. There are other pages that cover upcoming events, tell more about the GATV crew, plus please check out our sponsors links page whose support makes GATV and GATV Online possible. New to our website is our flight training page with loads of information about becoming a private pilot or a sport pilot, including links for flight instruction and ground school. We always like to hear from our viewers, so drop us an email with any comments or suggestions. That's GATV and GATVonline.com.
And clear.
Many different helicopters are manufactured in a wide variety of styles and models, each one suited to their own particular task. Although helicopters are very versatile, some designs are targeted to a specific mission, while others enjoy the flexibility of being used commercially or private. I actually started flying helicopters first and then later transitioned over to fixed wing, so I've always held a special place in my heart for rotorcraft. The majority of people are most familiar with helicopters giving them their morning traffic report or being used in law enforcement. Because of their versatility, helicopters can be adapted to perform many different roles, and because of their maneuverability, helicopters can perform maneuvers that no other aircraft can match. In this short confined area, a crop dusting fixed wing airplane would be hard to match what this helicopter can do with ease. Some helicopter designs allow you to lift incredible loads, while others have been configured for a specific task, like this 500 that's being used for patrolling power lines. Inspections and repairs can be made from the air, which would be virtually impossible to do in remote areas with ground crews. Flying men and equipment out to the oil rigs is another job that's perfectly suited for the helicopter. With many of these rigs being 100 miles or more offshore, using a boat, especially in rough weather, would be more time-consuming and expensive. Helilogging uses heavy-lift helicopters to remove timber from remote wooded areas. This minimizes the impact on the environment. Having the ability to move lumberjacks in and out of the forest and being able to retrieve their lumber, all without the use of roads. This allows lumber mills to surgically remove the mature trees that they want without disturbing the surrounding forest. What happens if these forests happen to catch fire? Well, now that's where a helicopter really excels. Having the ability to fill its water tanks from virtually any water source, a helicopter can be on scene fast and drop its water on the fire with pinpoint accuracy. Another important role for the helicopter is search and rescue and life safety. With their ability to airlift people out from remote areas and transport accident victims, they are often the difference between life and death. After a trauma, the golden hour is the most crucial time for a victim to get medical treatment. The helicopter's ability to land virtually anywhere and transport a patient to the hospital quickly saves lives every day. The corporate world also values the importance of a helicopter. Having the ability to get to a meeting fast and in comfort, and in many cases land on the very building that the meeting is taking place, may give your company the edge. Many tour companies also use helicopters as a safe means of transportation to get their clients into remote areas with majestic views. And what morning commute would be complete without a traffic report brought to you by your local TV station using a helicopter? Many law enforcement agencies have active air units that use helicopters to patrol from the air and assist their deputies on the ground. With sophisticated mapping programs and forward-looking infrared cameras or FLIRs that can see through the dark, many agencies consider their helicopters an essential tool. If you're looking for a weekend retreat or a primary residence in a residential flying community, Heaven's Landing may be just the place. Located in northeast Georgia, where they enjoy beautiful weather year-round, Heaven's Landing has a laid-back mountain lifestyle that is easily accessible through the use of general aviation. Here you will find 300 home sites, averaging 1.5 acres each, with taxable lots or spectacular mountain views and community hangars. Heaven's Landing also has a lighted 5,069-foot concrete runway that can accommodate everything from a Piper Cub to a Learjet, and they even have fuel on site. If you would like to find out more about this beautiful residential fly-in community, contact Heaven's Landing at heavenslanding.com or simply dial 1-800-HEAVEN-2. Treasure Coast Avionics in Fort Pierce is your one stop for all of your avionics needs. They have a huge inventory of parts and the expertise to service all major brands of electronics. Whether you need service certification or a panel upgrade, Treasure Coast Avionics can get the job done right. If you're looking for that new panel, they have state-of-the-art design capabilities with CNC machining to turn your dream panel into a reality. Treasure Coast Avionics is located on field at the St. Lucie County International Airport. Click on their logo on the GATV online website for more information. Have you ever watched a small plane passing overhead and wondered what it'd be like to fly? Well, here's your chance. North County Flight Training can start you on your way to becoming a pilot or even take you further into a career as a commercial pilot with their flight training from private through ATP. For those days when Mother Nature doesn't cooperate, North County Flight Training has a full motion flight simulator where you can log time and practice maneuvers in a safe, controlled environment. If you're already a pilot, North County Flight Training rents their fleet of aircraft starting at as little as $85 an hour, including fuel. And because they're affiliated with Aircraft Maintenance Specialist, who is the area's Cessna Authorized Service Center, they're going to rent the cleanest, most well-maintained aircraft available. Their Discovery flights are only $99 and make a great gift. For more information, call 561-694-9282 or log on to northcountyflight.com. This morning we're in West Palm Beach and we're with Captain Julie. She's going to tell us what makes her bird so special. You fly for Channel 5?
That's right, WPTV here in West Palm Beach. It's
okay.
A local NBC affiliate, yes. And we use this helicopter here, which is the 206 Long Ranger, the Bell helicopters. make a great product. This is the L4 version. We primarily use this aircraft for traffic in the mornings and breaking news as and when the TV station needs us to go and fly. It's a great tool, it's a great resource, it's very safe, very reliable. We have quite a lot of news equipment, monitors, scanners, radios. This is our nose camera, this is the FLIR. Very powerful. We can read a license tag on a car from about 1,000 feet. This is our primary tool that we use for breaking news. Everything in the news industry now is very visual, so having this very powerful camera, we're able to really zoom in on what we're looking at and explain it to the public, explain the accident scene and which directions of the interstate are blocked so that people can better plan their day trying to get to work in the morning. We have a flotation equipment on Chopper 5 because this is South Florida. We have Lake Okeechobee to the west. We have a lot of lakes, ponds, canals, and of course a huge expanse of Atlantic Ocean to the east. So these are a must-have item, basically. We can't go offshore without them.
All right, let's talk a little bit about workload. As a pilot of a helicopter, you're a lot busier than in a fixed-wing aircraft. But with this kind of ship, I can imagine you are very busy. Have you got any help in operating all the equipment?
I do. I have a photographer in the back seat, Yonghan, my photographer. He's an aerial photographer, so he's used to flying. He understands airspace terminology. He can understand the control tower. He's kind of really a second pilot without being an actual pilot. He has no ratings. So if I need traffic aversion, he's always got his eyes on the skies for me as well. So we share. I have the primary task to look and see and avoid, but he also shares that responsibility with me. So that's a great asset to have. As well as running the camera, he operates all of the microwave equipment to the TV station. So he frees me up a lot so that I can concentrate on my pilot duties, but on top of that also my reporting duties.
Well, we've heard a lot of your reports, and it just seems like it's very busy because you're having to fly, you're having to watch for traffic, you're having to give reports on where the traffic is or whether it's a wreck. It just seems like you're juggling a lot while you're up there.
I am. You're multitasking is very much the word for an ENG pilot. Our primary objective, though, is to operate the aircraft as safely as possible. So that is the number one primary concern of the pilot in command, being myself when I'm operating this machine. So the TV station comes second to my pilot duties. And the good thing about my TV station is that they're very cognitive of that. And if I tell them that my workload is heavy today, I don't have to report. When I first go to a scene, the first thing I'm looking at is other aircrafts. Am I hearing other aircrafts? Am I seeing other aircrafts? Where are my airports? Where are my antennas? So we have our two-way radio that we talk to the TV station. We have the police scanners. We have a marine radio. We also have the TV as well, all going through this headset. So what I do before I do my report is I kill all of my volumes except the control tower. And then pretty much as I'm listening to the control tower and I'm reporting, I can answer them during a report. And I do. Quite often you'll hear me on the air saying Chopper 5 got that traffic, will maintain visual, and mm-hmm. then go right back into my report. So it does seem a lot, but I've been doing it for quite a long time. In the beginning, there was a lot of times when I would not report and just concentrate on my pilot duties. But now it's kind of becoming very familiar and very, it's your comfort level, really. It's what right. you're comfortable with and how much workload you're used to taking on. Up to be a generic long ranger, so the instrument panel here is pretty much the standard panel you would see in any L4. Cyclic, collective, and the pedals. All the instruments would be generic for the L4. The instrument panel here is just a little extended. This is our audio mixer that we use where I can isolate my volumes. When I was talking earlier about how I can shut my sources off, I can do that in an awful hurry. If I'm on the air or the Katao is talking to me and I have too much communication in my ear, I can just push these all down into an off position and it immediately kills those sources so that I can concentrate on the control tower. Very exciting. It's always something different every day. It's kind of a little bit like police flying. You're always going to a call. You never really know what you're going to get until you get there. It can be very boring, very mundane at times when you're just flying traffic up and down the interstate. But for the most part, it's a fun and exciting job. Don't go anywhere. More from GATV and Chopper 5 when we return.
It's like flying a magic carpet, and if you want to experience it for yourself, Ocean Helicopters has a team of seasoned instructors that can train you for your private through ATP helicopter ratings with the FAA-approved Part 141 flight school that offers one-on-one instruction at your pace. Ocean Helicopters can also provide aerial photography, banner towing, and sightseeing tours. Ocean Helicopters flies the safe and versatile Robinson R-22 and R-44. Plus, for your turbine transition, they have the awesome Bell 206 Jet Ranger. An affiliate of Ocean Helicopters, Bahamas Helicopters has virtually the same services in the islands of the Bahamas. Ocean Helicopters is located in sunny West Palm Beach, Florida, where we fly year-round, and they can assist out-of-town students. For more information, contact them at 561-625-1900 or visit their website at oceanhelicopters.com. GATV's website and show are devoted entirely to general aviation. If you want to see your business soar, you should partner with us and our other sponsors so collectively we can promote the sport of flying. By advertising on our show and website, you can help share our passion for flying and expose more people to your business at the same time. For advertising rates, simply click on the airplane logo on the GATV online website.
Hey, OH 58 helicopters, an Army Surplus Observation Helicopter. That we acquired from the military. And it's a stable, slow platform, perfect for what we do in law enforcement. Okay, max gross weight on this aircraft is, on the ramp is 3,300 pounds. Max takeoff weight is 3,200 pounds. Usually with everything that we have on board, with a crew of two, we're at, right at about 3,000, 3,100 pounds. Calls for us to be, if they want us to come out, if we have armed robbery just occurred or in progress, burglary, breaking and entering, high-speed chases, missing children, missing endangered adults, such as elderly with Alzheimer's, people like that. And those are normal call-out calls in a normal patrol, depending on the pilot, depending on the time of day, whether it's at night or daytime, depends on what we're looking for. During the daytime, it may look in the wooded areas for stolen, abandoned vehicles. Through the shoreline, looking for illegal aliens coming up, washing ashore. At night, try to look at the businesses that should be closed, such as car dealerships, make sure people aren't trying to break into any of the vehicles in the parking lot, stuff like that. Now, if you'd like to see some of the equipment that we use to operate the aircraft, some of the equipment that's specific to law enforcement that we use, let's go.
Okay, we've got a couple different styles of helmets. We've got the what's called an SPH-4 Bravo, and this is a military helicopter helmet. These have the night vision mount mounted to the front so you can connect night vision goggles. You're going to look through the lenses at what the pilot can see, and ultimately you have infinity is what you're able to see. And this is looking through both lenses, but as you scan, you can scan along, you'll be able to see exactly what you see with any type of night vision. We're in a totally dark room right now, and we're able to pick up what's up on inside this room on the walls.
For more information on helicopters or becoming a helicopter pilot, contact the Helicopter Association International at rotor.com.
Make sure you read through the Pilot's Operating Handbook for every aircraft that you fly. Whether it's one aircraft or five aircraft, every aircraft has different operating procedures, so get very familiar with each aircraft that you are going to fly. After a long cross-country flight, even if you're flying to breakfast and you've already pre-flighted your aircraft for the day, after breakfast, come back out to your aircraft and remember, 4-3-2-1. Check the four warning lights. Check the three oils, the main rotor gearbox, the tail rotor gearbox, and your engine oil. Check the two fuel caps and check your sprag clutch. If everything's good, you're ready to fly. Before a long cross-country flight, make sure that you have planned the flight properly. Get all the frequencies and call the weather briefer. The weather briefer knows all the up-to-date NOTAMs and temporary flight restrictions, so it will protect you in the end. So make sure you have your frequencies, weather, and the flight route planned properly.
As you may have experienced at some time during your flying, you can be flying in reasonably good weather, and either the clouds start coming down or up and you're in the middle. Flying into IMC, instrument meteorological conditions, when your VFR is a very dangerous thing. See, if you were trained nowadays, you get a minimum of 3 hours of instrument instruction. The FAA felt that that was necessary because of a number of incidents like you're talking about, flying your VFR, flying into IFR conditions. Now, the more training you get in those conditions, with just using the instruments as your only reference, the better off you are. Even if you don't have an instrument rating, you're better off getting the training. 3 hours minimum instruction is just that, it's minimum. Doesn't mean you shouldn't get more, it's just in order to get your certificate, you have to have logged that much time. And you do have to take that training seriously. So it's just, okay, let's get this minimum requirement out of the way so we'll go out there and fly around circles with the hood on. Take it seriously. Learn how to really use that stuff so that you're properly trained. But there used to be no training required. And as airplanes become more capable, the pilot has to become more capable also.
Now for this edition of Hangar Talk with Master CFI, Jim Alsop.
Welcome to GATV Hangar Talk. My name is Jim Alsop. Each week, Dave East and I will share with you flying tips, anecdotes, and comments that we hope will promote your flying for fun, flying for style, and flying safely. The laws of motion, as formulated by Sir Isaac Newton, describe how and why airplanes behave in the air and on the ground. A good pilot who attempts to make an airplane move contrary to the laws of motion does so at his or her own risk. Ask and allow your airplane to move in accordance with Newton's laws, and you will be known as a great stick. Newton's first law, or maybe it was the second, states that a mass, an airplane, will continue in a given motion until acted upon by a force. In pilot talk, that means chill out. If you change the power setting, change the trim, change the bank, you need to allow airplane time to react to the new forces. The control pressures you have changed. You have to allow time for the old motion to stop and the new motion to develop. Be patient. It takes time to change the motion of an airplane. Impatience frequently leads a pilot to violate Newton's second law. For every action or force, there is an equal and opposite action or force. I like to state Newton's second law this way: do stuff and other stuff happens. If you do something to affect A, stuff happens to B and to C and to D, sometimes with dire consequences. Stop wiggling the controls. That causes a lot of other stuff to happen. As an example of Newton's first two laws of motion, I like to tell the tale of that pesky wind shear some pilots always find lurking when their airplane is on short final. Typically, the pilot does not recognize right turning P factor on a long descending approach to final. Instead of holding left rudder pressure, he or she allows the airplane to turn right off runway alignment. Using aileron, the pilot turns the airplane back towards the center line. But alas, the airplane starts to move right again. This might happen several times during the final approach. As the pilot plays rock and roll with the ailerons, the plane loses lift. Drag induced by adverse yaw builds inertial moments, first left and then right. Airspeed decays and the nose drops, causing the pilot to apply back pressure, losing even more airspeed, creating additional yawing moments. By now, application of power seems reasonable, and so it goes. In the cockpit, he or she looks like a one-armed paper hanger. In the end, the pilot chases airspeed and pitch and that elusive descent rate all the way to the runway. But he or she manages to grease it on. The pilot is quite happy with his or herself for making a great landing in spite of that pesky wind on final. Perhaps you're saying, but Jim, Newton has three laws. That's right. Newton called his third law his force equation. I call it the rule of the big gorilla. That gorilla has turned a good day ugly for many pilots. I will save that discussion for next time. Dave East and I hope you enjoyed this edition of Hangar Talk, and we look forward to our next time with you. Thanks for watching, and if you enjoyed the show, please tell your friends. My name is Jim Alsup, reminding you to have fun, fly high, and keep the blue on top.
This episode of GATV has been brought to you by Aviation Insurance Resources, Adventure Seaplanes, DataToys Digital Video Systems, Ocean Helicopters, North County Flight Training, Treasure Coast Avionics, Dillon Aviation Master CFI Jim Alsup, AVMAP Satellite Navigation, Heaven's Landing Residential Fly-In Community, and Piper Aircraft. When we travel to film GATV, it's always in our dependable Piper. But that's all we have time for. I hope you enjoyed the show.
If you get a chance, send us an email. We would love to hear from you. And if you're not a pilot, go take a discovery flight. You'll be glad you did. I know I am.
But if you are a pilot, take a kid flying. Fly safe.